Good morning, everybody. I can tell you it's beautiful weather outside. It's a nice day to go to Amsterdam and look to the city. But you prefer to be here. And I like that. We had a wonderful day yesterday, and I think we even have a better day today. So you made the right choice. And I promise you, we have nice weather in the weekend, so take the weekend off. Good morning. On behalf of the Dutch Healthcare Inspectorate and the Netherlands Organization for Health Research and Development, I cordially say welcome to this beautiful day. I thank Maureen Bisignano from IHI, and I thank Fiona Gottlieb from BMG that they have made it possible to bring this great international conference to the Netherlands. We owe them a lot, we have learned so much from them, and we will take this opportunity to learn as much as we can to spread this movement of improvement and safety to the Netherlands. Thank you very much. Let me introduce myself a moment. I'm Wim Schellekens. I'm the Chief Inspector of the Dutch Healthcare Inspectorate, and I'm involved in quality improvement quite a long time. You know, my personal motivation to do quality improvement work and to work on safety is that healthcare is meant to relieve suffering, to help patients, to cure them, to care for them. But in a way, bad quality and unsafe care adds suffering to the patient. You know, wound infections, bed sores, medication errors, waiting, no information, adds suffering, unnecessary suffering to the patient. And that's not what healthcare is all about. Healthcare is to relieve suffering. And it is my personal motivation to relieve that suffering because we have to help our patients to relieve their suffering. So bad quality and unsafe healthcare, let's get rid of it. Yesterday, Maureen told us about personal stories you can read on the New York Times website. There are 220 patient stories about 30 illnesses, and nothing is more strong to convict yourself that we are in a really serious business is to read patient stories. So I advise you to go to the New York Times. But it's also important to listen to the stories of the doctors. There is a booklet in the Netherlands that showed 11 stories of famous doctors in the Netherlands, really known doctors in the Netherlands. And they told their own story of a very serious patient incident or a calamity. And this booklet was translated into English, just special for this conference. And you can have it free. It's at the entrance. So take an opportunity to read about 11 doctors who are very open about what their personal story was about a very serious patient incident. I have some announcements to make. Please join us in lunchtime at 12:45 for a meeting, and that's about the Dutch healthcare system and it's about what we are doing in the Netherlands about quality improvement and safety. So if you are interested in what we are doing in the Netherlands, please join us at 12:45. You also can go at that same time, during lunchtime, that's competing with each other, to the Dutch Corner. And there will be a presentation about implementation strategies. And then there is an extra session at 1:30 this afternoon, and it's about bringing together the things about guidelines, improvement, safety, and external assurance and control and supervision. And it's brought by Francis Elliott from Scotland. He's CEO in Scotland. So if you want to know something about that, go at 1:30 to room G from Gerald or Geraldine, 109, G109 at 1:30. Then I have to thank our sponsors that make it possible that we are here. And I call their names because they owe it. A.T. Kearney, Baxter, Bupa, Dr. Foster Intelligence, Hildrom, Medtronic, Pfizer, and the Dutch Council for Quality of Healthcare. And now I'm very proud to introduce our plenary presenter this morning. I'm very honored to introduce him because he is in the Netherlands a very famous, very well-known person. He was the former president and CEO of Shell Netherlands. And you know, Shell is a company with a yearly budget that's bigger than our national gross national income. So in a way, he led a company that is bigger than the Netherlands. He now is Member of Parliament in the House of Lords for the Christian Democratic Party. He is very special to us because Rein Willems, within Shell, gave top priority to safety. He made safety a central issue in his business strategy. And that was the reason that in 2004, the Minister of Healthcare asked him his advice, how can we improve patient safety in healthcare? What can we learn from Shell that we have to adopt and have to implement in healthcare? And in that time, I visited him in his office in The Hague. And when I arrived by car, that building was in reconstruction. And there was a big sign on that reconstruction area and that said, this is a safe workplace. I never entered a hospital that said, this is a safe hospital. Second thing I noticed when I came into the building, that it is a rule within Shell that you never walk the stairs without one hand on the railing. So you are not allowed to walk the stairs without a hand on the railing. So you can't go with your papers in both hands walking down the stairs. That's too dangerous. And it's a very small thing, of course, but it's a sign, a symbol of what safety can mean in a company. But he can tell about it himself in a much more eloquent way. So his report to the minister made it possible in the Netherlands to set the floor for a national patient safety campaign. And we still are very busy in the Netherlands because of the report of Mr. Rein Willems. The floor is yours.
Wim, dankjewel. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Wim, for the introduction. Yes, this was the report that Wim referred to. But let me give you some background first. I started working with Shell in 1970, and one of my first courses, and I started working in Australia, was a course called STOP, STOP, Safety Training Observation Program. This was learning from DuPont, a company in the United States that has started its work in the area of explosives and really developed a safety program. As you can imagine, with explosives, you have to do so, which was used widely by other industries around the world, and then the oil industry as well. Safety training observation. It says all the things that you need to do. You stop at certain times because safety is more important. You observe and you train people. And that's how my life in Shell started, with training on safety. And yes, we worked with very unsafe and unhealthy and problematic materials. Fuels in the industry are explosive and burn. And I can still recall, after 1.5 years working, that I found this one maintenance man standing under the column, an ethylene ethane splitter, which is a very explosive gas, and he stood under that smoking a cigarette. And, well, fortunately there were no leaks, nothing happened, but I took the man in my hands, walked him outside the gate, and I said to him, look, you never come here anymore. You've been told not to do this, and you never come in here anymore. And if you don't make sanctions every so now and then, show the outside world that you mean seriously that safety is an important thing, then you don't make progress in this issue. But we've still had, as a company, to make significant progress in the period since. I also had a very personal reason to
to get involved in this subject, particularly when the minister asked me in 2004. My father had died in 86 as a result of a medical error. And yes, the situation was then, and I can still recall in our family, he was 71 years old, he had lung emphysema, his life wasn't easy, but nevertheless, he'd never been in hospital, and after a few days in hospital, due to a medical error, he died. And you rationalized that in the family, said, yeah, but his life wouldn't have been very nice anyway with the lung emphysema, the worsening lung emphysema. But nevertheless, His situation was that he died as a result of a mistake. And when I got this opportunity to help the Ministry of Health, I took that. We spent about six, 7 months with a group of people, also from the medical field. I name a few: Harry Molendijk, Ian Leistikoff. They are the authors of the booklet that Wim referred to, and Wim himself. And they helped me go through the medical hospitals and the medical system, because I'm not a medical. I've got some brothers who were involved, and brothers-in-law who were involved in the medical field as surgeons, but. You come from the outside, and the first reaction, by the way, from the trade unions was, how is it possible that a man from the oil industry can talk to us about safety? We're not drums of barrels of oil. The patients are not and anyway, so there was this reluctance of accepting outside advice. And we felt in the end, and I was able to explain to the people, that also our industry took outside advice. Throughout our whole experience in the last more than 100 years, we took advice from the airline industry. When they came through the situation and upgraded their safety systems, we listened to them on how we do things. When we do big shutdowns of refineries, we take checklists now, as the airline, the pilots take checklists. So all these things, you go to another sector of society, you try to learn. And I found in my first conclusions after the first couple of months in the roaming around, visiting hospitals and talking to patients, organizations and others, that I had actually two main conclusions. One, there was an enormous dedication of people taking care of others. I mean, there was no doubt about that people were doing their work with great intention. And it's a sector in society which probably excels in that. But at the same time, I concluded that safety wasn't managed at all. There was no system in place. There was no thinking about, apart from the few jewels, and I referred already to Harry Molendijk, who started with his work, and there were some others in Katharina Ziekenhuis in Eindhoven. There were a few areas where people were indeed starting with this program, but throughout the whole, the issue was not managed. And I was then pleased to sit down with them and develop a few simple guidelines. And I'll go through with you through those simple guidelines that we then revised. And it in the end became a very, very simple booklet, very thin, with a few practical advices that I'm pleased to know that still people refer to every so now and then today. It's even amazing that these days people do PhDs on this subject. And there have been two or three in recent years. So at least it has got a much more serious scientific attention as well in the Netherlands, and I'm sure outside the Netherlands as well, as I've seen from the various posters outside here. One of the underlying things with safety is that you have the so-called iceberg theory, and I'm sure most of you would know about this. The iceberg theory, where you can see that for one, now this should work this way, that if I point my finger here, you should see it. Yeah, for one fatality, you have underneath the water a series of other issues, like lost time injuries. When something happens to somebody and he has time off for work because of the injury, or you have property damage or minor injury, or you have accidents with no injury, or even unsafe acts. And throughout this process of the period of the last 40 years, I recall that we first started to work with, well, if you had a fatality, you really had to take some steps as a reaction to the real incident that took place. And within maybe 5 or 10 years, we started to monitor very closely the lost time injuries and started to manage on issues on the lost time injuries. Now, throughout the time period, we now manage in a company like Shell the unsafe acts.
Because those are the underlying things that in the end cause accidents with no injury or damage, or cause property damage or minor injury, or cause lost time accidents, or in the end cause fatalities. So we don't manage fatalities anymore. We manage the unsafe acts. And I think that's the essence of good safety management, that you go through your hospitals and manage those. So major incidents can be prevented by managing the underlying causes of insignificant events. And when you go through that, you come in the end to a set of statistics, which in the company Shell, and forgive me that I still talk about this company that I've left 3.5 years ago, my blood, I have to say, is red and yellow after working such a long time in that company, and you can't blame me for that. And it's still running well, I can tell you. The graphs here are index graphs, so these figures don't mean the exact number, but they're indexed, and they're measured in million man-hours worked, or incidents per million man-hours worked, or per 10 million or per 100 million, as it may be in this graph. But the important thing of this here is that you see the yellow one, which is the total recordables, incidents. Here we measure, and we've started doing that since the end 80s, measuring the total recordable incidents. And these are just incidents like in a hospital where you've noticed that something has gone wrong. It's not done the right way. And you record that, and you discuss that with people. And in the beginning, when you set up such a process, you don't manage for that number to come down. You actually expect when you start with that whole process for it to go up, because you haven't noticed it before. People are reluctant to record those issues. So as management, you first sort of take a very open attitude and are surprised that after 1 year or 2 years, the number has gone down. And that probably indicates that people are still scared to report or start to avoid reporting. So you actually manage the system such that people really become open in reporting. But after a while, when the whole system is so accepted in the whole organization, you then notice these figures going down. And yet you don't steer on them going down. And if they are very low, and in a large organization like Shell, where you can compare situations in the Philippines with Brazil or US or UK, when you notice significant difference, you can then still start asking yourself, is it right that when there are so few recordable incidents in place X, are they really taking care and reporting well? Is it statistically acceptable that that number is so low? And very often you find underlying, when you start the discussion with management, yes, there is a culture of, well, we don't always write it down. We discuss it, yes, but we don't always write it down. And there you can see that the discipline has started to fade. So you can, as a system overall in an organization, take action on these things. The other lines are indicating the blue line on top, as you can see here, if this thing now works. Yeah, no, I should. Yeah, the blue line, it's a very complicated thing here, is the fatality rate. That is indeed the number of fatalities that happened per 10 million man-hours worked in an organization. And yes, an organization like Shell with over 100,000 people working and another probably 40 to 50,000 contractors working in various construction projects has one or two or sometimes three or four fatalities per year throughout that organization. Most of the time in the contractor area, even though one manages the contractor's staff in exactly the same way as their own staff, we treat everybody working on a site as exactly the same way. And when Wim referred to the situation around the workplace in our office, yes, our staff have and contractor staff have to accept the standard rules of how we work here. And the booklet was called, I show you, here you work safely or you don't work here at all. And that is, in some of our refineries at the gate, a statement that's very clearly present. And people, when they come in, they realize that this is indeed the way one works here. And it's even possible that at very low levels in an organization, now take a refinery in Pernis in the Netherlands here, one of the larger refineries in the world, that an operator at weekend service, when he feels that something is unsafe, he can decide to shut that plant down.
He has that authority because safety has been given down to the lowest level in the organization to take care if things need to be taken care of. And and I think that's the way safety has now ingrown in the staff of that whole organization. One of the key processes in place is a system of risk management, risk assessment that's been taken care of when you get involved in large projects or when you have certain standard operation in the organization, like a shutdown of a major plant. You generally do a risk assessment. And you have a matrix of all the issues that can take place, and you have issues that are never heard of in industry. Issues that are heard of in industry, for instance, the Fukushima incident. Yes, that was heard of in industry because it happened before in Three Mile Island and in Chernobyl. So you would rate the Fukushima incident here. And you can then look at the severity. No health on the left-hand side. The severity is a very low severity with no health effect or injury, or a very high severity with multiple fatalities on the bottom side. Now, each standardized operation, you make a risk assessment, like a shutdown of a plant or whatever. And you have risk assessments throughout your organization, and you then take appropriate actions. It's very clear that if you end up sometime in this red area, you have to continuously monitor and check and work the issue. When it's yellow, you still have that under constant surveillance, and when it's blue, you do more or less incidental checks. You still keep a watching eye, but you have standard procedures in place at least to take care of that situation. I would say that the Fukushima situation is somewhere around here at the moment. Where are we? Somewhere around here. Like there will be multiple fatalities around there, as is likely, and it's heard of in industry before. And it has had to be in a situation of continuous surveillance of systems, whether they were in place or not. And time will tell what the real problems have been. But it's very clear that many people around the world are trying to learn from such an incident. And that is a process, and I would recommend that to people in the hospital or the health world as well. Make a standard thing of learning from others. And openly discuss things and then learn from others to how you can do things better. That is the real only approach on how you can ensure that the statistics not only improve, but that patients feel comfortable that this is a place where they're being safely treated and they're properly taken care of. The other thing in place is what we call health and safety management, HSEMS, health and safety and environment management system. In a company like Shell, we all describe things in the tripartite health, safety and environment as issues that management has to manage very clearly. That management system has to be in place in a refinery, in an office. And as Wim reported in the early statement, yes, we have a simple thing. When you have railings, why not use them? And we found too often that in factories where you have these metal railings and operators walk around in their heavy boots and their heavy gear, yes, we ask them to hold those railings because it helps them, it avoids them not falling, having one grip. There is the general tendency of people want to do things right and work hard and have their hands full of things and then walk up the stairs. We have noticed that it has prevented a significant number of falling incidents when people hold those railings. And an interesting story, when once said to the real CEO of Shell globally and myself walked down the stair at the start of an analyst meeting, and the photographers became in one of the Dutch papers. Some of the operators in our operations in Nam and Groningen saw this photograph of the two of us with a piece of paper in our hands in this large stair in the Shell office in The Hague, not holding a railing. And yes, we had worked in this office environment where we said, well, this is not a plant environment and you don't think about it. And we got this email from the operator and it said, Mr. Willems, what's good for us, is that not good for you two guys? And they were not right, so I immediately said back, you're absolutely correct, and I will make sure that in this office we have the same rules as we have as you have in the plants in Groningen. So yes, we then did follow that, and I had to convince people in the Hague office, and it's typical of an organization, we said, yeah, but it's not a factory here, we don't have to work like that here. And I said, well, if we want to show an example and that this is the culture in an organization, we have to do it here as well. Because these people who work here will go to factories as well, will give advice to people, and they have to realize that it's the same simple rules that we use here. It's a simple story that I tell you here, but it shows you that it has to do with the culture of an organization. The things that you have to, you've all seen the cheese slices here with the holes in it. A typical, good explanation of when an incident happens, an occurrence happens and things are not right, the holes in a protection system. Normally when you have one protection system with a hole and it goes through, you have a serious risk of something happen. We have four protection systems like it's indicated here, and they have holes in it. And you know they have holes in it because we are not perfect. Nobody is perfect. But when you have significant number of protection systems, the chance of something going wrong, of course, reduces significantly. But in the end, you may still have an incident. And yes, as people sometimes say, shit happens. Sometimes things do go wrong. And we all know that. The booklet that Wim showed of earlier is a great story of doctors in hospitals talking about their experience when a problem happened. And I think that's great that people come out and openly talk about that. Here, when you have an incident in a workplace, you have an incident reporting system, you have a tripod analysis, an incident investigation with a tripod analysis, looking at the root causes of the incident, and you then report back. Are there trends? Have these types of things happened before? In other parts around the world, so you have a group of small staff of health safety environment people who analyze these incidents and report back. It's a very small number of people actually in a big organization because safety has become is owned by management themselves. We used to have in the 70s a situation that the safety manager was responsible for safety in the plant, and the manager went on producing and making money for the organization. You had that separate organization. And after in the 80s, people realized that this is not the right thing to do. Safety has to be managed by people themselves in the organization. They have to realize that it's part and parcel of their life to make sure that people can work safely in the workplace and can happily go home after that. You then check whether there's been a violation, whether there's a survey, whether there's been violations. And sort of these are the actions on the right-hand side here that are all taken care of after the incident. And these are the systems on the left-hand side here that you do when incidents not happen, but make sure that the systems are in place. You have site visits. Senior management goes around, and these things don't work very easy, but site visits, when senior management goes around, you generally take out an hour for visiting the plant and go around with some of the operators and say and show your interest in what's going on and ask questions about safety, how they live safety in their organization. You have a self-appraisal system. You have a job hazard analysis. You have a permit to work system. For certain dangers at work, there's a very clearly registered system of permits that's required. For instance, when you need to do welding. Yes, you can do welding in a plant that's running, where hydrocarbons are going through the pipes. Yes, you can even weld a piece of pipe on an oil pipe where there's oil going through. But you have to do it under very precise and strict conditions, and you can do that safely. But you have to make sure that everybody follows those strict procedures, and you have check on check on check to make sure that these things are right. And they're very similar things to operation rooms in hospitals. You have clearly training programs, competency programs. Are people indeed geared up to the responsibility of taking care of other people? And the whole thing is encompassed in a set of clear standards and procedures throughout the whole organization. And basically all people are aware of it. And last but not least, all people are equal in an organization. Contractors have to live with the same standards, and we are taking care of them in the same way as if they are our own staff.
You can only do that in order to make yourself believable in the organization, because otherwise you cannot afford a situation that you have second-rate citizens that are being less important in your organization than your own staff. That's something about the HSE management system that needs to be in place. There is the culture ladder in the organization, and over time, and when I compare the situation of Shell in the early 70s, you had a pathological reaction to when something went wrong, a fatality, you immediately took action and started to look around what you need to do to avoid it. Generally, this evolved through a situation of being reactive, to being calculative, we have systems in place to manage all hazards, to being proactive, we work on the problems that we still find, and generative, HSE is how we do business around here. And I would say, if I take this graph of the periods, I would say this is the pathological, is the 70s of Shell. Here we have, I'd say, the 80s of Shell. Here we have the 90s of Shell, and I would say that we are just about here now. Maybe not all areas still fully generative, but it's still something that's really so ingrained in the organization. And we're looking at what's the next thing, because is this indeed sufficient in the end? You see it a bit similar here in this graph, a fragmented approach in the beginning to a systematic approach to a behavioral approach at the moment. And that's the crucial issue to managing safety. It has to be a behavioral approach. A shared purpose of belief, an aligned performance commitment, and an external view. Let other people from outside come in and challenge you. And then, in the end, and that's a statement I'd like to make to those cynics who always say, yes, it costs too much money and we can't afford it. Good safety management saves you money. I'll give you an example for that. When we have a fatality in a factory, and I take the US situation, which is very much more litigious environment than, say, Europe, when you have a fatality, you always get a court case. When you have your systems in place and you can demonstrate to the judge that you really have got a proper system in place and that management is taking care of that, and nevertheless an incident still happens, you generally don't get a fine. You get the normal arrangement of taking care of the people in an appropriate way, but you don't get a fine. When you don't have your system in place, the judges will be pretty severe with you, and it will cost you millions. And the cost of that, and I know the system is not as litigious yet in Europe, it's developing, unfortunately, more and more, and now maybe that's a value judgment which I shouldn't make, but it is developing. And the fact of the matter is, I think that hospitals will have to take care more and more that they avoid this. And I can advise people, you can only avoid it if you make sure you have the system in place. Then you don't have to care about these cases, because you are open with the patients and their relatives if something goes wrong. The report then came with a set of recommendations, basically four. The first recommendation was every hospital has a certified safety management system as of the 1st of January 2008. That was the advice in 2004. We said, well, 4 years it should be possible. If you make such a change in Shell, it's 2 years, but, well, it's not managed like a big organization, so we take 4 years. I can tell you, 2008, that target has not been met. And at the moment, there are now hospitals that have a certified system in place. There are a number of the 100 hospitals, nearly 100 hospitals in Holland that have system in place, but certainly not all hospitals have it yet. You see a statement here at the bottom, VNCI members. This happens to be the Dutch Chemical Industry Federation. And one of the things we did is we said to hospitals, if you want advice, free advice, go to the health and safety offer of the chemical factory close to your location, and he will give you, help you, free advice to set up a system. And I know it happened in at least a dozen of situations in Holland that the hospitals went to their local chemical factory and got advice from the company. Companies like Dow, Esso, and Shell, and Axo, and DSM happily supported the hospitals in setting up their systems. Again, learning from the outside world. So this was recommendation one. Key element to this whole thing is a system of blame-free reporting. Report by department, simple report form, and give fast feedback. don't make it too bureaucratic. Have maybe once a week a 15-minute timeout with your staff, with the nurses, and discuss the issues that happened during the week that have been reported in the book. And when there is an issue that you can't solve, go and ask an expert, inside or outside. It may sound cumbersome. I tell you, it works because people get excited about it and they start taking care of what it means to be working safely in a hospital. And then indeed make sure that you aggregate the reports to the hospital reporting program so that you get an idea of do all departments really take place or not. The second recommendation is the hospital board is responsible. This sounds ominous, strange maybe for most of you, because obviously they are responsible, but I can tell you, with the polder environment in the Netherlands, where everybody feels responsible, and in the end nobody is responsible, this situation has happened too often. You have the eternal situation of the discussion where you have the commercial director and the medical director, and sometimes it's not clear who's really in charge of the hospital, or if it's a commercial director who is in charge of the whole hospital, the medical people say, well, I'm responsible for all the medical issues, and those issues are not always very clear. In the end, the man at the top is in charge, and he has to call the shots, even on safety, even when it relates to medical issues in the hospital. And then we have the issue that a lot of doctors are not formally employed by the hospital in the Netherlands, but they are employed in so-called societies, where the whole society, or maatschap as it's called, is having a contract with the hospital. And there again, they have a sort of very often a too free-off mentality, are not supervised sufficiently in the whole issue. That's an issue we found, and I can say some progress has been made in the area, but I think hospitals still have a long way to go to really make sure that people and the specialists in at the moment in hospitals, or consultants as you call them in the UK, are really feeling that responsibility. I say that because when going around, and I'm on the board of one of the university hospitals in Amsterdam here, what we find is that generally the nurses are clearly taking well part in this whole blame-free reporting system, but the doctors don't yet. They feel it's for the other staff to take care of, but the doctors to a lesser extent take part of it. And in the end, I think it has to be everybody's responsibility to take properly part of that. So, the hospital board is responsible and has to take steps. I have been pleased that since 2004, the inspectorate, of which Wim is a member of, has closed at times some wards or some operating rooms in certain hospitals, really to make people feel, because that in the end, if you don't comply, the only way to do it is close a sector and let the people feel it in their pocket. And that's in the end what made things happen. And that's in the end the same thing happens in large organizations like Shell. If somebody for the second time makes a mistake, you're out of a job. And I had to do that in my time in the Netherlands here, take a senior staff member out of his job after a serious incident in one of our locations. And it happened the second time, and we found that the root cause was that the way he was managing his staff was in strong part attributable to the way safety was managed in that organization. So yes, sanctions are in the end necessary, but you begin with managing the culture in the organization. The third recommendation was health insurance companies give preference to safe hospitals. Yes, we have a more free market development in the Netherlands where health insurance companies lure patients to have insurance with them. They are also the ones who have contract with hospitals, and they should take a more, I don't know what it happens here, but more proactive step to, I don't know what this means here. Options. Well, hidden. Yeah, it works. Okay. See? They themselves, in the end, can steer this whole process of safety management in an organization. The fourth recommendation is the government needs to show power and responsibility, and I would say that is clearly the case, although the obligational steps by law has not been introduced, and I'm still at this stage reluctant to say that you should have a safety management system by law, because the risk with doing something by law is that people will do tick-offs and say, yes, we comply, but their heart is not in it. This whole system can only work properly if the heart of the people is in it, and the heart of the management and the heart of the doctors and the nurses is in this whole issue. And it is moving the right way in a pretty fast speed. I'll come back to that later when I look at some observations since 2008. Well, what has happened since 2004? Most, if not all hospitals have started with safety management. No hospital is as yet fully compliant. There are now one or two that have recently been certified. It takes a lot longer than, say, in the airline or chemical industry. And I just wonder sometimes why. Yes, it's not a clear organizational structure as an oil company or an airline company where the bosses on top can say to all the hospitals, and now it has to be done. We have 100 different hospitals in the Netherlands, and they all have their own boards, and they all have their autonomy. So yes, that that has been conducive to it taking much longer than necessary. But in that whole process, and that's why in the end I have advised not to immediately make legislation yet, although ultimately I think you need to make legislation to safeguard the whole situation. But in the process towards it, let it develop of people doing it out of their heart and as a cultural element. And then hospitals and governments and specialists have agreed that in 2012, this has been an agreement by the surgeons organization, that by 2012 every hospital has a safety management system. And they have developed a checklist now, the SURPASS checklist, which I think is being used now more and more widely, if not in most of the operation rooms in hospitals. My observation from outside. Still, the boards of hospitals do not exert sufficient leadership on this issue yet. I think there is still, at times, a reluctant attitude, and sometimes it's even worse that the whole hospital goes wrong, as we've recently found in a hospital in the middle of the Netherlands. But and that, in the end, now in private hands, has shown to be able to manage costs dramatically and improve safety dramatically. In my view, it still takes too long, and I still believe that the argument, and I still hear that argument at times, that it costs too much, and we have to put people on the subject, and we have to look at our costs in the hospital, and we can't do it. It is the type of investment in people, and it's not real big money in terms of equipment you have to do it. It's people's time, and it has to start with senior management. If senior management in the hospital are not convinced that this is the right thing to do, you have only a very small chance that these things are properly addressed to it. And I think the situation, we are now in a situation that the supervisory boards of the hospitals have to really make sure that it's ingrained in their role as well as supervisory board, that they monitor what's happening on the safety improvement programs in hospitals. And this is something that, again, you can put in law, or at least in formal government regulations. The government in safety inspections is indeed actively monitoring now, and you see more and more that where things go wrong, they take appropriate steps. And I think that's the right way to do. Give warnings to people, give another warning, but in the end, you have to have sanctions. There have to be sanctions, and people have to realize that there is a limit to what you can accept in unprofessional behavior. The HSMR, you all know what it is now being published in the Netherlands. It's not freely published yet, if I remember right, but at least all hospitals know what their rating is. And the standard thing that you still hear is that when people are too low on the rating, they say, yeah, but our situation is different. Our situation is different. We have those particular cases that others don't have, and I can tell you, this is exactly the same story as a refinery in Philippines, as a refinery in Brazil, or a refinery in Pernis. No, we said in Brazil, our situation is completely different. We have people with different education. It's that you can't compare it with the Netherlands. And I can tell you, these issues you can compare all over the world. They're all standard. They're all the same. And mark my word, this HSMR, and maybe you have to modify something and learn to do things better, in the end will be a good indicator of whether safety is taken seriously in a hospital or not. And that's what it's all about.
As I said, governance is still too relaxed. There's no clarity still in quite a few hospitals about who is really in charge. Has the managing director of the hospital, if he's not a medical, does not have a medical background, and that can happen, you can still do a good job managing a hospital. Has he got the authority over the medical staff when it concerns safety? When you start probing on those issues, it's not always very clear. And this has to do a little bit with the Dutch culture. I'm sure people in the States and other parts of the world will find that a little bit different. But we have a polder culture of being responsible together, and at times, therefore, these responsibilities are not taken clearly. It's improving. So if I'm positive about it, I say it's a lot better than 4 years ago, but I think we've still got a way to go in Holland. And in the end, why can pilots and engineers work with checklists and doctors not? Again, the positive side is the doctors have taken serious steps. SURPASS is now fully introduced, and being positive about it, I think that is really working. But we're not there yet. Then observations continued. If I give some ratings, I would say blame for the reporting at the moment. I give that a 7 out of 10. In the Dutch school system, you can have a 10 and you're excellent. And I know in other countries you have different ratings, and A levels or B levels. In the UK, blame for reporting 7 out of 10. Prospective risk management still 4 out of 10. I think a long way to go. But again, there is good progress. There are many jewels of actual work done. And just one in a hospital recently where in a family with 2 young children, the wife gone to hospital and after a few days in hospital died. In the end, straight conclusion that mistakes had been made in the treatment. But the hospital had taken the risk of being completely open with the father. And the end result of that, to make a long story short, is that the father participated in making a movie, a short movie, about 15-20 minute movie, of the whole incident. What had gone wrong, analyzing what had gone wrong, how he participated in this process. And now he actively playing a part in that little video, 20 minutes, to explain to, and it's used for training purpose to others, that the openness has helped him accept the situation, and how he wanted to make sure that people took learning from these mistakes, and he wanted to participate in that, because he said what happened to my wife should not happen anymore, and I'm happy and prepared to participate in that process. I think it's an adult reaction if somebody says, yes, mistakes do happen, and how can we make sure that they don't happen. It's a very intriguing and heart-moving video. Some of you, I'm sure, have seen it. And I'm sure similar things do exist in other countries. But it's again emphasizes that in this whole process, it's learning and learning and learning and learning. I was able to participate in a conference a year ago from the Society in Europe for Simulation Applied to Medicine in Groningen. And I've seen indeed that in very many ways people do now training with simulation apparatus, computer simulation, and I think it's a great tool to help train people. And it's very similar to what happens in big refineries. You use training methods, you simulate incidents that can go wrong, and then look at the reaction and see how people react to that, and make sure that yes, they accept that. Some things go wrong, but how then do you cope with that and manage that? I asked the stage master who's sitting at the back of it here before walking in, there's all the people in the room here, if something goes wrong and somebody really gets a heart attack in here, what do you do? Well, we call the doctor. Fine. Good. But is there a process of making sure that everything is done? Huh? And do you sometimes do a check? All those people in place to say, by the way, we actually do a learning exercise here, and it's for your safety that we do it, but we move everybody out of the place here in order to make sure that not in the case of a heart attack that you have to move everybody out, although at least maybe surrounding it, yes. Do you do training exercises to prepare yourself for events that could occur? The Dutch surgeons started an action plan in 2008, And I read through the whole document, and I have to congratulate them. They have probably been the last amongst the specialists in the Netherlands that have taken up the whole thing seriously. But then again, I think they're doing it thoroughly now, and I'm convinced that with that work, they will move up in the ladder of progress in this whole area. My last question to you, ladies and gentlemen, is the following. Does this look like your hospital? Thank you very much.